When I try to flash OpenWrt on my Belkin RT3200 Wi-Fi 6 router, I bricked it. In fact, I flashed the wrong image. The Belkin RT3200 has a specific memory layout that is not optimized for OpenWrt. Hence, there are two versions. One that does convert the UBI memory and one that does not. The one I chose from the OpenWrt site did not do the UBI conversion. That means that the memory layout of the router was unchanged. But then I flashed a version that expected the new UBI layout. That crashed the router and all I got was a blinking power LED after the reboot. Let me first show you guys what I did in order to unbrick it. And then we will have a look at how to flash it properly in the right order. Oh, and again, quick reminder, if you want to buy one, then please use my affiliate links in the description. Much appreciated. That will give me a small commission on your purchase, but you won't pay more. Many thanks, guys. If your router or generally speaking hardware that runs Linux is broken or bricked, then you usually have three options to unbrick it. Either the hardware has a built-in recovery mode with a read-only base system that you can't override. That's true, for example, for the D-Link routers and the recovery console. Some devices can boot from the network if you press a certain key combination at boot time. Or, that's your second option, if the recovery mode or recovery console doesn't work or is not available, then many devices have a serial port connection. Very often, however, those connectors are inside the device. You can connect to those by using a UART, a USB to serial converter. So you have to open the case, and useless to say, that definitely voids your warranty, by the way. Just saying. If you are lucky, however, then you can connect to those pins using a terminal software and you get a prompt from where you can then take emergency actions, such as transfer a new image over Kermit, X modem or Y modem, or load a firmware over TFTP. If things went really belly up, that means if you have overwritten the bootloader of the device, which by the way in 9 out of 10 cases is a software called U-Boot, then your third and last option is JTAG. In a nutshell, JTAG gives you direct access to the router's hardware on a very low level. You can halt the processor, debug code, inject instructions, root the device, or, in the most common situations, use it to reflash the U-Boot bootloader. Unfortunately, the Belkin RT3200 does not have a recovery console. Now, I was, let's say, half lucky here. Half because I did have to open the case, but lucky because I got a U-Boot prompt at boot time. And hence, I could simply download a new binary over TFTP. Before I did that, I actually thought, why not directly upload it to the device using the X modem protocol over the serial interface? But that reminded me how slow our world was before we got Ethernet. Sending the firmware over the serial line would take 20 to 30 minutes using X modem at 150 kilobits per second, while TFTP did it in a couple of seconds, really. Well, yeah, even a 100 megabit connection is, of course, 1,000 times faster than the serial line. I tend to forget that. So here is how I did it step by step. First, how did I get into that situation? I followed the how-to on the OpenWrt site, or at least I thought so. I went to that GitHub site here and read through the steps. Then I downloaded the recovery image from the OpenWrt device selector. And that was the first mistake. I should have read the documentation more thoroughly, and hence I would have noticed that the image I uploaded to the router using the Linksys update firmware function was the recovery image, but not the recovery image installer. First mistake, so that one worked, but did not convert the memory layout. So when I then went to flashing the snapshot firmware, it broke the router, because that firmware was expecting the converted memory layout. So if you are doing this, then make sure that you use the image from the DangoWrt GitHub here first, and then upload the sys upgrade image from that GitHub site if you want to convert the UBI schema, and only then upload the latest snapshot from OpenWrt directly. We'll go through these steps one by one, don't worry. Anyhow, the router was bricked, so I had to unbrick it. First, I opened the case and located the serial connector up here. Then, I used those small clamps here to connect to the RX and TX contacts. I connected the ground somewhere else on the board. You could even connect to one of those metal chassis parts here. I then connected the UART, which in fact you can buy at, I'd say, $2 to $5 at any electronics shop. On my laptop, I installed a terminal software. There are many of those. Hyperterminal, RealTerm, PuttyTel, or TerraTerm. Once I switched on the router, I got boot messages flying by, which is good, because that showed me that the bootloader was working. UBoot greets you with this option screen. If you do nothing, then it will attempt to boot from the internal memory, which of course failed. If you set your terminal software to ANSI or VT100, then you can actually even use the arrow keys and select an option here. The first option is the one we want. Transfer the image over TFTP. So I downloaded and installed a TFTP server software, such as OpenTFTP, to my laptop. I then downloaded the correct recovery image installer from the GitHub, copied it to a shorter file name in the subdirectory of the TFTP server home directory, which I specified in the TFTP server setup file. I then started the TFTP server, switched on the router, and selected the first boot from TFTP option in the serial console. Of course, you will have to adjust the IP address of your laptop to an address in the same subnet like the router. I used 192.168.1.254. And also, you would have to connect the network cable of your laptop with a LAN port of the router. Once the router could download the image, which will be indicated by those hashes here, it will launch the installer software. You can see here that it's actually converting the UBI storage. Awesome. Now I could log into Lucy, and you notice the difference here. It tells me that this version of OpenWrt is read-only, and that I have to flash a new image in order to get the full joy. That's what I did. I installed the sys upgrade image from the GitHub, and only then did I install the sys upgrade image from the last snapshot. As the snapshot image doesn't have Lucy installed, I just did an opackage update and opackage install Lucy on the command line and halted the device so that I could reassemble the case. Cool. I could have saved me the additional work if only I had read the documentation more thoroughly. But hey, this is how we learn, right? And I was able to share that experience with you. So as a summary, here are the steps again to unbrick. First, install a terminal software on your PC. On Linux, you may also use the screen command. Then, connect a UART or USB to serial converter to the USB of your PC or laptop. Select the serial port of your UART in the terminal software. On Windows, you can double check in the Device Manager application. Set the right baud rate. For this device, it's 115K 8-bit SATA, no parity, one stop bit, or short 8N1. Set the terminal emulation to ANSI or VT100. Download and install a TFTP server software. I used OpenTFTP. Modify the setup files of the TFTP server so that it knows where to find the firmware file. Then, download the right firmware file, rename it to something shorter, and copy it into that subdirectory. Next, open the case of the router and locate the serial connectors. Connect to the RX, TX, and ground pins. Here is the layout for the RT3200. Connect the three pins to the UART. Next, connect a LAN port of the router to the network interface of your laptop. Set the IP address of your laptop or PC to a fixed address, for example 192.168.1.254. Now launch the TFTP server on your PC. If you get prompted by the firewall, then allow access. When you switch on the router, then you should see the boot messages in the terminal window. If you don't, then maybe you have mixed up RX and TX, or you have selected the wrong port or baud rate in the terminal software. At boot time, use the arrow keys if you have ANSI or VT100 terminal emulations on, or alternatively, select the menu option 1 by typing the number 1. Now answer the questions. Mainly, you need to specify the IP address of your PC and the file name of the firmware file. The router should now start the network interface and download the firmware from your PC. If it does not, then check that your firewall allows traffic and also double check the file name. I had to specify a leading backslash for this to work. Once the device has rebooted and installed the recovery image, then you may log into Lucy and flash a normal image. So, hopefully that works for you, but of course, it's much better to not brick the router at all, but rather follow the steps in the documentation thoroughly. Here are the steps in the right order again to save you the headache of unbricking it. And guys, these steps will do the UBI installation. That means they will convert the memory layout. First, download the installer images from the Dango WRT's GitHub repository to your local PC. Then log into the Belkin admin page, go to Configuration Administration Firmware Upgrade. Click on Browse and select the file which you have just downloaded. This needs to be the recovery installer image. Then click on Start Upgrade. Your router should reboot, and once you reconnect to the 192.168.1.1 address, then you should have the OpenWrt recovery image, from where you can go to System, Backup and Flash Firmware, then click on Flash Image and select the Sys Upgrade image. Once you reboot, you should have a running OpenWrt image, and you may again upgrade to the latest snapshot Sys Upgrade image from the OpenWrt site directly. The last two steps might have been redundant here, but after my bad experience, I thought better be safe than sorry. Again, if you follow these steps, then you have converted the UBI memory and you cannot go back to the stock firmware easily anymore. You would have to convert the memory layout back first. But to me, this will most probably not happen because OpenWrt is so much better than the original firmware. Last but not least, why did I choose this device and not any other Wi-Fi 6 device? Well, at the moment, and that again is valid in January 2022, there are only half a dozen Wi-Fi 6 routers supported by the OpenWrt project. All of those use the MediaTek MT7915 chipset, and that's a really good sign. Why? The developer behind those drivers is actually a member of the OpenWrt project. That means that MediaTek contracted an OpenWrt member to write the drivers for their hardware. Furthermore, if you check the mailing lists, forums and the commits on the OpenWrt MT76 GitHub, then you will see that there is a lot of activity. So that means that there are a lot of contributions to that driver at the moment. A second potential candidate for Wi-Fi 6 with OpenWrt might be the ATH11K driver for the Qualcomm Atheros chipsets. However, those drivers are much less open source because a lot of stuff in that hardware is handled by the firmware. At the moment again, in January 2022, things might have changed when you watch this video in the future. There is only an experimental build available for the Qualcomm chipset using the proprietary drivers and backports. Many routers these days claim to be running OpenWrt, but be aware that this does not necessarily mean that they can run the official version, but rather, very often, they use older versions with closed source drivers. Guys, if you want to know more, and if you want to understand why these Wi-Fi drivers are such a big problem under Linux, then I suggest that you watch this video. That is actually a speech that the MediaTek driver developer Felix Fiedkau has given in 2015 at the Chaos Computer Club conference. While I'm sure that things have changed in the last 6 years, it still gives a great insight into the challenges that you have if you want to develop a Wi-Fi driver for Linux. Perfect. That's all for today. I hope you liked that episode. If so, then a thumbs up is much appreciated. Please do leave me a comment and make sure you subscribe to my channel so that you don't miss an episode. Many thanks for watching. Stay safe, stay healthy. Bye for now. Kamera aus.